Passivation of the solar cell surface is one of the most important topics as far as efficiencies of these solar cells are concerned. So in this video, I want to introduce why do we require this surface passivation. And I want to also introduce this terminology and introduce this new term, which is surface recombination velocity, and how that is used as a measure to find out how good the surface passivation is. So first of all, let's understand a little bit what's this all this fuss about the surface. So we know that in our semiconductor, in this case silicon, we have these periodic atoms, periodic lattice structure, and that results in the formation of these very beautifully placed conduction and valence band, and this band gap which separates or which distinguishes between these conduction and valence band states. So this is all fine and true when you have a large lattice, or you have these large number of these silicon atoms, but things begin to falter as I move at the surface. So when I reach this surface over here, I see these silicon atoms which have not fulfilled all their bonding requirements. So all of these silicon atoms have one or more dangling bonds, which essentially, ideally, they would like another silicon atom to be present on the other side. But since it's not, it breaks the symmetry of this lattice, and it results in this formation of these states which appear in this forbidden region, or in this region of the band gap of my semiconductor. And these are typically what is called as the surface states. And these surface states act as a very good recombination centers. So for example, if I have electron in the conduction band and this hole in the valence band, so when they reach near the surface, they can utilize this surface state as a trap center and use that to recombine with this hole present in the valence band. So now, why is this problematic for a solar cell? So let me explain that using a band diagram of a PN solar cell. So I have this, let's say this PN junction over here, and let me draw the band diagram over here as well. So I have this P-type over here and N-type semiconductor over here, and this is my depletion region. So now if I shine a light on this, this will generate these electron and hole pairs throughout this solar cell. It will result in generation of these electron and hole pair throughout this solar cell. And now I want to collect these electrons at this particular electrode on the N-type electrode, and I want to collect these holes at the P-type electrode. But whenever I'm forming these electrodes, I'll usually have a surface associated with over there. And now let me consider the case where I have these surface states present at near to the electrode where I'm collecting these electrons, or I'm collecting these electrons and holes. So now these when this electron reaches close to this n-type contact, what it sees is a large number of surface states present over here. So instead of getting collected, it can essentially now use this surface state as trap center, and it can recombine with this hole present in this valence band. Similarly, this hole present in the valence band over here, or this electron present in this conduction band over here, they can also recombine using this surface states. So instead of getting collected, now this electron and hole pair are just annihilated due to this recombination which is happening due to this surface states. So it's very important to reduce the density of these surface states, and a good metric to measure this density and the effect of this surface recombination is to use this term surface recombination velocity. So let me explain how this surface recombination velocity is defined. So let's say I have this unpassivated surface, and I have this semiconductor over here, and I have this unpassivated surface, And I'm shining light on it, so I'm going to generate some some excess number of electrons and holes. And let me consider the case of these excess electrons in the system. So when I'm far away from this surface, then I have this excess carrier of electron present, which I denote by delta n. Now, because of this source of recombination present in the surface, when I'll approach the surface, this excess number of electrons will essentially reduce, and I'll expect a profile something like this when I approach the surface. So I can represent this diffusion current, which results because of this gradient in this concentration profile of my electrons, and I can essentially represent this by this diffusion constant multiplied by this gradient in the concentration of these excess electrons. And I can equate this term at the surface, and I can define this as equivalent to having a surface recombination velocity at the surface, and this curve is going to multiply by this same excess number of electrons, and that would essentially give me the same diffusion current. So if I do a dimensional analysis now, the unit of this surface recombination velocity comes out to be centimeter per second, and that's why it's called as a surface recombination velocity. And let me consider two cases. So let me consider the case in which the surface recombination velocity is zero. So in that case, what it means is that there's a well-passivated surface and there's no recombination happening over here. And in that case, there'll be no gradient in this carrier concentration as it reaches the surface. On the other hand, if the surface recombination velocity is infinite, then according to this equation, this delta n has to be equal to zero to maintain this finite diffusion current. And what it means is that for surface recombination velocity equal to infinite, this excess carrier concentration would reduce to zero as I approach my surface. So this is for surface recombination velocity equal to infinity, and this would be the profile when surface recombination velocity is equal to zero. So I can denote this excess number of electrons by this quasi-Fermi level as well. So I can denote it by this quasi-Fermi level. So in this case where this surface recombination velocity is zero, this quasi-Fermi level remains flat as I approach this surface. Versus the case when this surface recombination velocity is infinite, then this surface recombination, this quasi-Fermi level, it approaches the value of this intrinsic energy level of the semiconductor. In that case. So let me give you some values of what the surface recombination velocity numbers look like. For the case of crystalline silicon-based solar cell, the best surface recombination velocity, again best meaning the lowest surface recombination velocity, have been reported around between 1 to 10 centimeter per second. But on a typical day, on a normal day, you know, when the sun is shining, the birds are chirping, the surface recombination velocity in these most of these silicon solar cells which are manufactured tend to be around this range where they are between 100 to 1000 centimeter per second. Typically when this semiconductor surface is passivated with a metal, or there's this metal semiconductor interface, then this surface recombination velocity tends to be, you know, in this higher around 1000 range. If I have a completely unpassivated surface, this surface recombination velocity could be as high as 10 to power or 10 to power 6 centimeter per second. That would mean that all these carriers that come in in proximity of the surface, they are essentially recombined using these surface states. So it's desirable to essentially have this as far as these solar cell are concerned to have this surface recombination velocity as low as possible. And there are multiple ways that people try to achieve that. So you passivate your surface with thermally grown silicon oxide, and that passivates a lot of these dangling bonds, and it leads to a reduction in your surface recombination velocity. Similarly, there are other approaches, such as the surface recombination velocity is maximum when this you have equal number of electrons and holes, so you have both electrons and holes present close to the surface, so both of them can recombine with each other. So the surface recombination is maximized when you have n is equal to p. So usually there are techniques applied such that you repel these one kind of carrier away from the surface. And two such techniques are use of this approach called back surface field, and another is the use of fixed charge present in the oxide. And this would be a topic of the next video on this topic.